Hello, today is February 17th, Friday, and I have with me Peter Chan, and we are meeting for the first time. We spoke for maybe 15 minutes now, and we continue our conversation. Hey, Peter.
How are you? Здравствуйте.
Здравствуйте. And what we do? Peter is doing CE5 protocols, and he's interviewing me to for the group.
Yes, because it's good to see somebody in person to make sure he's real, and there is a chemistry. We get along. It's important that we have a cohesion within the group. It's because it's based on meditation, our emotions, and the ability of no fear of the unknown.
Wow. No fear. Lots of fear, but, you know, we don't focus on it.
Yes. We don't focus on it because fear is, they use that a lot in religions to control the population.
I love religion. All religions, we love everybody.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, basically, it's all about love.
And today's the weather is crazy. It's San Diego, but it's windy and rainy, but not cold yet. And Peter came on a foldable bicycle, which was very interesting.
Yeah, I got rid of my car a couple of years ago. I've always had cars in San Diego. And I decided just to ditch the car because of the global footprint. I was tired of paying insurance. I was tired of being the chain of the... Pain to play, and this is part of my spin class. I combine that with the bus system and train systems, and I get around this way. And that's how I get around to do camping in CE5. I take the Amtrak and I go to Mount Shasta, and I'm there. Or I go to Sibis. I take the bus to the end of the stop, and it's only 14 miles by bicycle, and I'm there. And I usually get a lift back. Because it's so foldable, it's so tight. It's a Brompton.
You can't do it in Chicago. Actually, I did bicycle in Moscow in the winter.
It's kind of rough in Moscow.
It's rough, it's possible.
It's possible. You got to probably stay in the sidewalk. They'll run you over, probably.
Oh, you have to like look behind, look on all sides. But yeah. You can't go on the snow with a bicycle. You can. Where it's flat.
Where it's flat.
Uphill, you can't go. Right?
No, you need a set of tires. I take the fourth gear, you walk up. It's my fourth gear.
Right. That was young.
No, but this is San Diego. We have no excuse. I call this Copenhagen, San Diego.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Oh, so you told me about Stephen Greer and about your experiences, right?
Yes. I actually was in the ghost phenomena way before Dr. Stephen Greer. It was not until my brother asked me questions about... certain ancient artifacts in the alien world. And I said, I have no proof. I just can't assume. I'm an engineer. We need proof. Uh-huh. And I happened to run into not just Dr. Stephen Greer's work, but Richard Dolan's work.
Oh.
Richard Dolan is my friend on Facebook, and he's a historian. Uh-huh. And I
know Dolan.
I love his work because he's factual. He has the documentation. It's great for the foundational part that, oh yes, it does exist because officials that are credible have said, yes, it does exist. With Dr. Stephen Greer, when I saw 2001 Disclosure, I was totally fascinated. We have pilots, we have military people, we have people in high ranking. It's not just anybody off the street. These are very educated, very articulate people. And I was just floored. And at that point, I knew there's something going on. It was not until Dr. Stephen Greer mentioned how he made contact. It was through the meditation process. At that point, I turned the video off. I said, this is crazy talk. I am not going there. Mm-hmm. This is a bunch of crap.
I did?
Yeah, for 2 weeks, I just let it go.
Really?
And then I thought, oh, let me think about this. There was Moses and all these other guys back in the old days. Maybe there's something going on. Maybe there's something I don't know. I should go into more. So I went into more research into Dr. Greer. And where did he get his information from? It was from the Vedics. It was from India. It was from the Vaitanas. And I said, oh, wow, let's go even deeper. So then I figured, oh, my God, there's something going on with consciousness. Ghost phenomena, consciousness.
Uh-huh.
The Monroe Institute.
Right.
I'm part of that group in Poway. It's consciousness. And it's like most things are made of space. and very little is made of matter. So what is this space all about? Maybe it's consciousness that occupies all that energy in space. Started, I was Dr. Stephen Greer, and I got some training in 2012. It took me 3 years just to finally drop the big bucks to go. It's not cheap. That was the big factor.
Right.
But it took me 3 years of research and figuring this out, and then I finally went and we saw things. Totally fascinating. And then I started my own group a couple months later. It all fell up in line, really. It started with Costa McRae up in San Bruno. He does ET List Talk. I was looking for information on how to make contact. Then after him, it was Dr. Greer's movie. And then after that, I got picked on his team that same year. And Costa said, how'd you get picked on his team? Nobody gets picked on the team the first time around. I said, I don't know, but my birthday is 2012. And when I was in San Francisco in the hostel, I projected out to him, I want to go this year. I visualized it. I sent the message out to the universe. And bam, there I was. He picked me for the first time around. And then I got trained in 2012. And then I started a team. In 2013, six people, was very, very well balanced. I had two psychics. I had a near-death experience guy. I had a hiker. And I had another guy that had experiences as a child. Uh-huh. So it was very well balanced. I was merely a pimp. I can get people together, and I can organize and form teams. But I'm tend to be more balanced, I think, in left and right brain, being a pianist and being open-minded about these things. So I could be logical, too. So because, but anyway, it was a good team.
What did you say your birthday was?
Birthday? My birthday?
Yeah.
12-12.
12-12.
5-7. 5 and 7 is 12.
Why 5 and 7?
I don't know. 5 and 7, 57. 1957.
Oh, you're older than I,
right? Yeah, it's 12. So you got all these 12-12-12s. All these threes, if you sum up the numbers, 1 and 2 is 3.
Got it.
I got that from Randy Powell, which was Vortex Mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
It involves the zero point.
Nice. I just want to make that more pretty. Even pretty. Like,
oh, yeah, but you can edit it. And,
no, I don't want to edit.
Okay. It's like nice and raw. Good raw, real footage.
It's just editing. It so takes so much time.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, that's what
I just kind of upload it.
Yeah, so I had a good team the first year. We got radio interviews, not just once, but many times. And some of our members had individual interviews with internet radio shows. And I started posting on Facebook live videos, and it caught on. People like that. They're hungry for
right.
Like ghost adventures. We had ET adventures.
So did you get any of their orbs on the video?
Oh, yes. We do have orbs. My second team around, Cameron caught some orbs in Mount Shasta. He's very much in tune. We can see those orbs on ET List Talk. Costa actually published them just last week. He's promoting his school, and one of his videos, Cameron's videos, is on there. Mm-hmm. Also, if you go to our CE5 San Diego group page, it should be posted on our group page somewhere. There's some orb videos, but we don't have a camera guy. You know, we're just everyday folks. But if we have a camera guy that shows up, more power to it. Because I always tell them, if you want to see that orbs and UFOs, there's plenty of YouTube videos.
Right.
I'm here to make a connection with our friends. And
I'm hesitant. If I see a UFO, I wouldn't even pull my phone out because, you know, there's so many good videos.
Right.
You know, if they want me to, if they ask me to photograph them, I would. But otherwise, why would I bother?
Right. It's too much extra.
Yeah, things I don't want to go wrong. I would rather meditate and connect to them and telepathically rather than, you know, try to photograph them.
Right. And almost cheapens to me. Does it cheapen the experience? I mean, it's like meeting a new friend and taking pictures of your friend.
Right.
That's
what I'm doing right now, right? That's what I'm doing right now.
Yeah, I know. No, it's different.
No, it is the same.
We're promoting the...
But I asked first. You know,
did it. Yes, I totally get you. I totally get you. But you'll be interviewed too by Ray soon.
I will?
Yes, because we're having a channel for our CE5, a documentary. basically, and we're gonna have.
Oh, you mean?
Yeah, yeah. If you join our team, you know, we're gonna.
Got it.
And once we get all gelled up again, it, as the team grows and expands, again, teams always grow and expand and contract. It's a normal thing. It's not for everybody.
But the reason I do your, I take video of you because we co-create basically.
Yes, we do co-create. Yes.
I think what you tell me right now as we meet is so nice to capture and. We share our experience and publish that. I think it would be nice.
For I think so, because everybody needs to get out of their freaking closet about this. It's data. Basically, it's data. People see these things. It should be recorded, and it should be studied in the physics.
All right. Suppose somebody doesn't hear, haven't ever heard about Greer and haven't ever heard about CE5. So until now, they didn't get any point, right? So we have to explain what it is.
Oh. Explain what it is. Oh, CE5.
Yeah.
CE5 is what I think, if I remember, our categories of the extraterrestrial experience. CE1 is where you see it. So many.
It's close encounters.
Close in the first one. Type is, one. I forgot what it was.
You watch it, right?
Yeah, somewhere far away.
Far away.
Two is, I don't remember. It gets closer.
It gets close.
I know four. You get pulled into the ship.
All right, abduction is four.
Well, why shouldn't I abduct? You're
or ex, you're they just
invited, you're in the, you're invited.
Invited for a visit.
You're okay. Invited for tea. I don't know.
I want four.
Four. Five is when we initiate the contact.
Right. So four is close encounter. They take you for a ship, but you don't initiate it. And five, no. You initiate.
We initiate, and they're surprised that we initiate these things. It's right. Like seeing a squirrel. Initiating contact with us.
Uh-huh.
You know, I mean,
no, I invite them since 2009. I invite them all the time. When I spoke first time to this dude, an alien, through the channeler,
mm-hmm.
First words I said, I apply for a visit. And I'm still waiting.
Right.
But this dude is not, basically, he said he can't, because they are in diplomatic relationships with human governments. They can't go over their prohibition. They prohibit to take humans so far.
Right. Well, I totally get it because I think it. I got some training from.
Hold on. I will pause.
For the first time with him, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's only four of us. That's when. That was during the government shutdown. So we did it, and the two gigantic white orbs show up over our group. It just popped up, just went to fade it. Popped up again and went to the north against the wind. Now, before we sat down, I make people sit down wherever they want to sit. Ted was facing south,
mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
They appeared at the south. I said, Ted, they did it for you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because this is holographic universe. They know what's going on.
Right.
They did it for you, Ted. That's why, okay, we did that. That's fine. Olga, she shows up a month later with us. She says, I was here before. 10 years ago, we initiated this place with me and some other guy. What are the probabilities? This is crazy! Crazy! This is, no, there's no accidents. This is all unfolding.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Olga was one of my good workers. She's like 20 years younger than me. We met in Kung Fu class. I thought,
Olga.
I would never, like, she's a kid. I'm not hanging out with her. And now we were, like, working together on this kind of work, like, I don't know, 10 years later. This is like, wow, this is too crazy. So it's all been planned out already.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the matrix that we live in. And now we're talking. Amazing.
So,
and I take Russian. I will never take Russian in a million years.
I don't know why we need Russian. Maybe something is coming, but I can speak English.
Yeah, no, we can talk English. I mean, it's just that, why would I study Russian? Because the connection was Joseph Burks. Joseph uh-huh. Burks, I met him 2 years ago, and he took Russian at UCLA, and his right-hand man, Misha, which is a fictitious name, by the way, was from Russia. Mm-hmm. I said, there's something going on. So I was just going to run with
it. Yeah, Russia is interesting. Russia is, there is so much desire there, desire to change the world. It's kind of, you push it hard, but from that pressure, there is a desire to change the world. So there is a lot of young people who are eager to do something. And they're very different. So the new generation comes, you know, they were born after the Soviet Union fell apart. So
they don't know what that is. It's just,
they don't know, but they...
They never lived it, yeah.
Didn't experience the restrictions. Right. So they have a fresh mind. So I'm open to work with them.
That was my dream, to have a CE5 team in that area of the world. And there's China. I'm Chinese.
Right.
There's a lot of friggin' Chinese that can really do this probably and get make some contact. That's a lot of people. So this, in other words, we're actually disclosing this organically on its own. We don't need the government. We don't need somebody to tell us. This is so organic. It's like one blade of grass. Mm-hmm. And more, you just can't get rid of that grass when it keeps going. So it's an organic movement. And I think we're headed that way. Fascinating. Totally fascinating. Although I may never master the Russian language, at least I could read a little bit and get around. Uh-huh. And I understand the culture and the history, at least. So I'm a little sensitive towards it. So, and plus I'm Chinese. I was born and raised here, but I studied Mandarin years ago to reconnect.
Can you speak Chinese?
Not anymore. I think I know more Russian than Chinese.
Can you cook Chinese?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
Qualified.
No problem. I can even cook Russian. Stuffed cabbages. Got it. But anyway, yeah, it'd be fascinating to spread to make new teams out. Yeah.
So I
are they more open in Russia about this? I heard.
Yeah, in Russia there is a tendency to prohibit so much that the system of prohibition becomes ineffective. So it's impossible to hide things in Russia. In America, they're so efficient, they can hide things, and they can, you know, really mess up the minds of the whole country. In Russia, they overdo it, so everybody is very suspicious. And it was in Soviet Union, even in the worst times, there were people who knew everything. And now, as I read, we studied, Tolstoy. Everybody knows Tolstoy. It's one of, you know, the second name in Russian. He wrote a big book, War and Peace. And a big part of War and Peace was about Masons and satanic cult. And it was 140 years ago.
He had of his time.
Right, Blavatsky was from Russia, and 1881 she published her Secret Doctrine, and there she talks about the aliens, about creation of the new human race, the sixth race, about ascension. It's the whole book about ascension, theosophy, founder of theosophy, about hybridization programs, Atlantis, Lemuria, you name it. You know, it was 120 years ago. So, yeah, and there are a few other Russians who were, like, writing about it, like Rerik and Andrei Bely and Gurdjieff. So, the whole country is sort of so repressive, but that culture creates stars which kind of look through and are trained to kind of look between, read between the lines and get the stuff out. And, my generation grew up on a book which is called Master and Margaret by Bulgakov. And surprise, it's about satanic cult, about, Luciferian cult. And it shows how the basically cabal controls the things. And it was written in 1920s, and it was written end of 20s, early 30s, finished in 36. And it surfaced in 50s, 60s, as just handwritten copies and photographed copies. And we grew up on that book. It's the main book which formed my generation. So we knew that even before it was popular in the West. But it was kind of fiction literature, but very profound. It kind of formed our understanding of the world.
Fascinating.
And, the author of that, he knew stuff. He was researching, and he was a son of a historian who knew stuff. He basically, they were connected to Masonic and other secret traditions.
Interesting. Now we're living it.
Right, now we're living it, yes.
It's amazing. It's like, oh my God. Well, they're crumbling anyway. Because everybody's waking up. The one thing they hate is that we know. They know that we know. Anyway,
right.
They like to be in the dark and work in the back. No, we already know. It's old news. Sorry. Old news,
right.
We're all meditating. We're all going out in the field. We're all making contact.
Right. The story about human colony. I told it a million times, so my people already know it. It's a short story. But basically, first thing I said to this dude was, I'm applying for a visit, right? So it was I was into Reiki, and Jim, my friend, was into Reiki. I just met him, and he was funny. He looked like a redneck, and he still looks like a redneck. Too simple, right? But so positive, so forward-going. I was suspicious. If people are too forward-going, you become suspicious. What is his interest? Why he would be that forward?
With motivation to doing this, yeah.
But he's still wonderful and forward-going. He's just an enlightened guru. Mm. And anyway, he started channeling. He said, do you know the aliens are around? I said, sure, aliens are always around me. Because I was told many times. Not that I feel them, but
right.
I told many times. I Pleiadians, blah, blah, blah. So he said, they want to speak to you. I said, sure. And he kind of let one of them enter. It was this dude. And he said, I'm this dude. I've watched you for a while. And I said, I'm applying for a visit. And he said, we'll consider your application.
He's applying for a visit.
Right. They have a bureaucracy.
I think that's hilarious. That's how...
They have a bureaucracy. You have to apply.
Yeah, I got it. I was like, wow. Right. Need a visa.
You need a visa, right.
Extraterrestrial visa.
Right. Exactly. I mean, it's electronic, but it's still a visa, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he said, but, we need to test your chemistry if you're compatible with our teleportation thing. I don't think Jim at that time knew the word. Worded right, but it was understood, like teleportation. So I said, sure, I give my approval. Next morning, I wake up, I have marks on my body.
Old scoops or just?
Like mosquito, big fat mosquito or bee bites.
Right.
They were 7 in geometric pattern, like angle.
Oh, okay.
And they stayed there for half a year. And right here.
Yeah.
And first, again, I would photograph the UFO. I would photograph myself because it is a private matter.
I totally believe you. I was like,
but later when it started fading and my belief started fading, I photographed just for myself to remind myself it was real.
Right.
So that was my first experience. It's very tiny, right? It's like, it's called stigmata. Like if you really believe, you get it, right? Stigmata, right?
Right, yeah, no.
Uh-huh.
Right.
So.
I did the Bach B minor, I understand.
You did what?
Christ stigmata. It's a fugue, the B minor fugue.
B minor?
Yeah, the B minor fugue, book 2.
What is that?
Johann Sebastian Bach's Prelude and Fugues. There were 24 sets, 2 sets. They had stigmata, and the fugue was based on 5 notes, and it made the melody. Stigmata.
It is a musical?
Yeah. He based it on the Christ crucifixion points.
Oh.
Stigmata.
And you played?
Yes, it's the B minor. If you analyze the fugue, it's a stigmata in there.
A fugue, okay.
Yeah, I mean, rough topic, but yeah, now
I don't know that language, right. Fugue, now I'm going to translate it.
Fuga.
Yeah.
Shostakovich, he did fugue also. Dmitri Shostakovich, he did the Preludes and Fugues.
Got it.
20th century.
Got it.
Totally cool. Anyway, back up. Stigmata, you had these marks.
All right. I don't understand Shostakovich. He's too complex for me.
Yeah, it's more for the,
I like simple.
People like me.
I like shamanic sound. Yeah, and African sound.
Yeah, I totally get you.
Simple. Ha, 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 yeah, ha, ma. That's simple.
I know.
All right.
Anyway, back to stigmata.
So, so they didn't take me, but it started me thinking, and I was thinking, I knew already, by that time, I researched David 𝗪𝗘𝗕𝗜𝗡𝗧was threatened by some bad guys. And he came to the interview the same day. He came to the interview with Kerry Cassidy. And it was a radio interview. Basically, his sound, he just called. He called and he said, I'm threatened. And something happened. So someone called to the same radio show. And that someone was anonymous, but he sounded, as I understood, he was speaking from a secret space program somewhere from outside of the Earth. So that was my understanding. So I realized, and I started researching it, I realized there are humans out there, right? It's not that all humans are here, all aliens are there. There are humans out there that grew up here and were taken there later. So basically us, us in the space. And there are different branches of that program. So I thought, I want to join them. But if I join them, I want to bring my friends and my family and make a settlement there. And there is a need for someone to explain the aliens what is there. What we are. Because when I started speaking to the aliens through the channeler, they were completely misunderstanding us. There was so little understanding that it was just laughable. They look at us, they were happy thinking about global problems, but they couldn't understand individuals, they couldn't understand politicians, they couldn't understand the governments, couldn't understand the economy. So those aliens who I spoke to, like, they were completely like ignoring the things. And I said, how about,
unimportant for them.
Yeah, you take us there, and we will make a settlement there, and we'll explain it to you the stuff, and then we do what the West did for the Soviet Union, to help the Soviet Union to fall apart and then reform. So the main idea, I experienced that from the Soviet Union. There was, it's called Voices, radio programs from the West. There was Voice of China, Voice of America, Voice of Germany, I think. I'm not sure if it was called Voice of Germany, but it was German, couple German stations. And my favorite was Radio Liberty. Radio Liberty was amazing, and it's still amazing. But at that time, it was instrumental because these were our people who emigrated, so they knew the stuff from inside. And that was the only voice who spoke with compassion. It was sad, compassion, loving voice all the time. And everything else was so lame. Like all radio programs in Soviet Union were lame. You didn't trust anything they would say. But whatever said Radio Liberty, it was reasonably trustable. Reasonably. Because there was that feeling there, which
right, it seems so you just know.
You just know, right?
You know the bullshit. You know, and what's coming is real.
Yeah. So I said, how about we start Radio Liberty up there? We create a settlement there, and we start radio whatever alien, radio friendly aliens, or radio friendly Russian colony, not Russian, human colony. So I called it human colony.
Earthlings.
And I wrote a whole book about it. It was like 2 months. I was just writing the letters for them. And I said, I created a Gmail for you. I will write my messages to that Gmail and you can upload them. You know, they should be able to access our Gmail, right?
Yeah.
Not that they did, but at least they should be able to. When I asked them in channelings, usually they didn't bother by some reason. I don't know why. But anyway, when I finished the book, they said they read it, they liked it, and it's helped them a lot, and that many, many aliens read it, which I believe, I mean, it's a nice book. It's called Welcome to Earth, A Guide for Aliens. So I read that book, and then it was, I guess, in the summer, and in September 2013, we kept couple times a week with Jim, we kept doing the channeling sessions. And I said, you know, so you basically they confirmed that they approved starting the colony. Yeah, it was end of September. Our friend Akur said it was approved. And I said, do you mind inviting people on record? And she said, I invite people. So I say, how about we just create an address and people would write there and apply. You know, that's simple, right? If you have a contact with the alien, they say we approve, so we can create an email address and people will write. So, and that started the community online. Basically, I published it in several places, started the website, started the YouTube channel. And tons of people joined us and applied. And there was an expectation that they will start taking us, right? And some people experienced, many people experienced at least the interview. The interview, basically, you apply next night, the same night, somebody comes to you like in astral projection state and they interview you. So many, many people confirmed that. They experienced that. And some people remembered going there, but most of the people don't.
Mm.
And I remember things like as dreams. Like I see people, I hold a child. I remember like a moment, like flashing memory. I hold a child and it's very dear to me, right? And things of that sort. So most of that is kind of, I don't know, we still don't know why. And they say they don't know why, but they take us as some sort of holographic projections and very little memory is kept. Mm. Elena Kapulnik visited there and she remembers stones more, and it's already on record, we asked her. So the colonies sort of exist, but they exist in some reality which is not very easily to address, access.
Mm-hmm.
But the community there, we have a few hundred people, we channel, and now we speak galactic languages. It's another story, basically. Many people speak languages for a lifetime, and then they find us, and they discover that there are other people who speak the same language. Most popular is Arcturian. Another popular is Lyran, Pleiadian, and snake language, reptilian language, so on. So that's another, that's a great confirmation. At some point, like Jim Kama came up with Arcturian language, someone else came up with Arcturian language. We had like more than, 15 people speaking Arcturian language. We had a webinar where, like we do it all live, where 9 people spoke Arcturian language, taking turns, and playing a play, some sort of a play, and then Jim translated what it was. And then he found a young lady who speaks that Arcturian language, who published that maybe 10 years before us, or maybe 7 years before us. So that was a nice confirmation. So people independently come up with the same language. Not many understand it, but some do. Some do. Now Wendy is pretty good. Brian is very good. Brian Sims is very good with galactic languages. He speaks perfect Arcturian, right?
Interesting. Has it been recorded?
Yeah,
it's all on YouTube somewhere.
We do it like live and recorded on Hangouts. Right. We have like tons of videos, hundreds of hours of videos, and it's like 3 years now. Mm. And every Saturday we have a webinar when somebody channels and there is like 10, 20 people asking questions.
Right.
It's all live and recorded all the
time. God, you're way over there. Yeah, you're way over there.
Yeah, way over there.
Yeah, we're just down home folks, just trying to make contact.
Yeah, we have the contact, right? But it's kind of it's channeled contact, right?
Yeah.
I want more tangible.
Right.
I got my confirmation, so I'm happy. Like most of my confirmations are of spirit nature. I basically there is that suspicion. Theory that, what if aliens are not real? What if spirits are real? And it's conspiracy of the spirits.
Right, now it's back. Yeah,
that
yeah,
they
yeah,
pretend yeah. to be aliens.
Right, right. And you don't know!
You have to test it, right?
You have to test it. You have to get no fear. Collect the data. Sort it out.
You have to be there. But
and Tom Campbell mentions this also. Maybe this is just a gigantic hologram. And the guy who's running the program is inserting all the data. It's not just the right direction. I mean,
but I interviewed several experiencers who visited the ships, and their stories are so real. So it's pretty real.
Yeah, well, like I said, maybe they're so advanced it seems paranormal. That's all. And I think it's hard for us to distinguish ghost activity and their activity. It's so close.
Another suspicion.
I always tell during our contact work, I know you hear the spirits, but not tonight. We have a date with ET. I always put that out there. I don't want to ruin the data tonight. But we'll see you next week. Just to be polite.
No, I do it all the time, yeah. Sometimes ETs bother me, like, you know, when their stories are not coherent, I say, let's speak to angels. And angels are much more, sort of, they're authorized. ETs are not authorized to release a lot of information. And angels are messengers. They are much more, they have more authority. So when ETs cannot answer your question, invite an angel, and angel will answer that. So So when ETs disappoint you, invite angels.
Okay. Well, I'll invite angels then.
Let's take a breath.
Okay. Taboos out there in the biology, physic world. If you start doing, I call it the woo-woo, does it hit a third rail?
People, it's not only the taboo, people just don't get it. It's like, for them, if you start speaking waves, you lose them right away.
Right.
The ones who speak waves, they don't understand the importance of that. They can speak about physics of it, get excited about nanometers, and that's about it. Mm-hmm. To combine the biology, the DNA, and waves, it's alternative science. There are several more names around, like Garayev, and Fritz Albert Pope, and several others. There is a community who speaks, but there are different angles at which you can approach that.
Mm-hmm.
So Garayev gave me a blessing. I spoke to him. He said, yeah, I believe it's right. But again, he was pushing his agenda at the same time.
Right.
He wanted to sell his stuff.
Yeah. Well, can you blame him? It's his life work, yeah.
Right, so I don't know. The story about origin of humanity, origin of man is interesting, but I'm still confused about it. That's another story very interesting, which I kind of dig through, and I'm finishing the book now. Yeah, it would be like my sixth book. That would be the update on the things and kind of the story goes that my friend's daughter, she's only 15 years old, and she's kind of a starseed child, which is very advanced.
There's a generation, I think, that's been changing, like Cameron's kids.
Yeah.
That one child can see things.
So she says, what can I read about aliens? And I look at my, you know, all the books I know. There is nothing for teenagers who...
Oh! Ray Dahl. She What's has it? Ray Dahl, the person that you want a friend on Facebook. Okay. She has a coloring book in Amazon for CE5 for children.
Uh-huh.
It's really cute. I mean, it's starting. It's out there.
Okay. So, yes. So, we need more books for people who are not clouded, who don't need proving. They just want information. So, I'm writing a book where I just give it as I understand it, without proving anything. Just, you know, Pleiadians are from Pleiades.
Mm.
Yahyel are from Pleiades. And so on.
Just put it out there.
just
No sugar-coated.
Yeah, exactly. Put it out there.
Yeah.
So I'm finishing that. So I guess based on that book, I will create my talk and then start speaking. First on YouTube, and then we'll see who wants me to listen. Exactly.
Yeah. Why not?
Why not, yeah.
You got to start somewhere. It's lonely when you first start out. You get like one view.
We have a reasonable number of views. Like our usual Jim's channels are about 1,000 views.
Wow, that's Kapolnik a lot.
Kapolnik about 10,000 views.
That's a lot. It's huge.
And me is about 100 views, but... No, actually 300 views. But some of my videos where I kind of get onto the right topic. You know Bashar, right? Bashar.
Yeah, I heard Bashar, yeah.
So at some point, Bashar said something which was on YouTube. And then he came through Jim. Bashar says something through Daryl Anka, who is his channeler, And then Bashar is a came through Jim on our webinar and also said the same thing. So I combined these two videos together and published that. It's nice, it's a nice proof when the same extraterrestrial speaks the same thing through two independent channelers. And I'm sure Jim is not watching YouTube. It's not...
Right. Oh, that's good. It's good to have confirmation through two different channelers. That's when I say, okay, there's something going on.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, we had that situation in one of our field work when the one channeler sensed it and then the other guy confirmed it.
Independently.
It was Dr. Gray at the time. But yeah, it was fascinating. I said, wow, there's something going on. I love it.
That's how the spirits introduced to me one of my incarnations. On the same day, I had two different channelers channeling to me. And I asked, what should I read to both of them? And they gave me the same book.
Yeah, it's confirmation right there.
That was nice.
Yeah.
They do like pretty things like that.
Right.
Nowadays.
Right. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
We can wrap it up. Is it a wrap?
Yeah, it's a wrap. Goodbye, everybody. Thank you for watching. Do you have any advertisements?
No advertisements. We're just a bunch of people that go out in the field and make contact.
You don't invite any people?
We have to go through the process. So the interview, fill out the forms.
How do they find you?
They find us through Facebook. CE5 San Diego. It'll pop right up.
Yeah, one word. CE5, Close Encounters 5, San Diego. CE5 San Diego. One word. CE5 San Diego. Search on Facebook and then you find Peter Chan.
Or one of our members. We're all on there doing our thing.
Yeah. Do you have any advertisements? Tomorrow we do Sean Swanson. Yay! Actually, I know that will be published after that. But anyway, Sean Swanson is the Yeshua channel, Yeshua from Yahyel for many years now, so it's nice to have him. And on Sunday we do Kapulnik. And I'm considering to start a subscription service on our YouTube channel. So you can find us on Human Colony on Facebook, Human Colony Group, private group. And join us on Facebook and join our discussions. And I invite, as usual, help with transcriptions of our channelings. And I invite help with hosting our webinars. Right now, Bree is doing all the hosting. And we need more work power. So if you are good with timing and technology, we can teach you, Bree can teach you, or I can teach you what buttons to press. And then we need hosts to host our hangouts. Thank you very much, and thank you for your attention. Thank you for being with us. Have a good day.
Robert Bingham is another initiator. He lives up in Los Angeles. He does it during the day.
And
he taught us how to do this during the day. We focus. And we did this with our CE5 San Diego during the day at our site, and things did show up. We had an orb show up. And it went across
the
sky. In the blue sky. It was a white little orb. But when we took a picture of it, it had spikes coming out of it. As if it knew what we were doing. Mm-hmm. it reminded me of the skull experiment. C-S-C-O-L-E.
I read about it.
Where they manipulate film or whatever. So there's something going on in their technology.
The spirits.
Yes, the spirit or maybe the extraterrestrial. We don't know. It's a possibility.
They introduce themselves as spirits.
Or they're so highly advanced in their technology, it seems very paranormal.
So for the viewers, the skull experiment was in England about 70 years, maybe more, about 70 years ago, I would say.
Right.
They have a book about it, and a group of mediums invited the spirits, and they had films, and the spirits would write on films, and then the mediums would develop it. And there was writings.
Something else, yes, absolutely.
And photographs, lots of information. Right. And it's all in the book. Yeah. And I like it. I have it somewhere here on the shelf.
Or maybe they've given us nudges of this is what the real reality is. So back to the the human factor. I think that Bingham said the reason that And when you first do this, you only get little bits and pieces. But if you get a lot of information, it will make you crazy. It's just, just too much. And you have to function in your day-to-day life after that. Right.
I'm already crazy, but, you know, I still can function a little bit.
Yeah, I can imagine.
I have to cook, right? So
right.
If you give it too much, you can cook them.
Right. It'd be too much. That's why they like to keep it at bay sometimes. You're still quite primitive. And
Dolan, I when I started, I Googled, I was in Rochester, New York. So first thing on the first day, I Googled UFO Rochester, and Richard is from Rochester, mm-hmm. so he came up there, and on meetup.com, there is a group of UFO interest group. So I came to their meeting, and I'm always late, but that time I was terribly late. I was like maybe an hour late. And it was best meeting ever. I didn't have such a good meeting ever again, but no more great meetings, but this was right to the point. That was an experience of certain lady. I don't think she named her on YouTube. Anyway, lady, let's call it her an experiencer number three. So this lady, she in her childhood, they asked her if she can help to save a race, and she still doesn't know which race. Is it our race or their race? But anyway, she agreed, so she is a volunteer, and she was a lifelong abductee and visited the ships. And when she agreed, she was smart enough to ask them, just let me keep the memories.
Mm-hmm.
Let me keep the memories. So she remembers tons, and I did like two series of interviews, about maybe 10 hours total. It's all on YouTube. So I tried to get, you know, whatever she can tell about the specifics, so I can ask somebody else and get confirmations. Like, what kind of, if they get you on a table, what kind of table is it? Does it have four legs, two legs, one leg, no legs, right? That kind of, you know, where is, how do the lamps look like? How the computers look like? You know, what is their dress? How do they when they talk telepathically, do they open their mouths? So, you know, that's an amazing experience. You know, there are others like that, but
right, I totally believe them. But what we do, we need three witnesses in our encounters.
Right.
I always require three people on the team to be there for validity. Yes, she's just talking, but if you put that in the sense of data, it's just her talking.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because reality is not so real, the experiences can be true for her, but not true for everybody else, right?
Right, right.
Now we have Kapulnik, Elena Kapulnik. She's also amazing, and she confirms a lot of things I already know, so that is nice. And Richard Dolan was there. He was basically guiding the group, and he was writing the books as he was guiding. So 2009, he already finished the main series of his books, but he kept writing.
Mm-hmm.
And soon he wrote the book, which is A Day After Disclosure. And when I saw him coming up with the idea, right there, he discussed it on the meeting, like it was just a simple slideshow. Then it was more sophisticated story. And then he started reading parts of it. And then he finished the book, and as I saw that, I realized I should write a book too. So I did the same thing. I did first a slideshow, and then I wrote a book, and I summarized what I knew. And my approach was different in a way. I really like channelers, so I focused on Bashar first, and then combined all channelers I could find, all experiencers I could find, kind of combined the story. And my main question, it still stands largely unanswered, is how is it possible that we evolved on Earth from primitive organisms, and we are related to our mice, to our fish, birds, we're all related. It's very close.
The DNA part, yeah.
So we sort of evolved here, and people show up from the sky who look like humans, right? And they say they have been here like a million years ago, before many things happened. So it's still an unsolved problem.
I kind of believe that maybe they could have tweaked the DNA in the monkey that we were. because we've only been here for so long, but yet advanced so much in our technology as a species. Usually species takes millions of years to evolve. Ours is very quickly.
Right.
And why in our jaw, there's a lot of like wisdom teeth that need to be pulled. Most animals don't have that issue, I don't think. Do they have extra teeth that they need? That's not necessary. Because you look at extraterrestrials, their jaws are quite small.
Right. I have a,
I don't know.
Every dentist tells me, like, you have so tiny jaw. And when they do x-ray at a dentist office, I say, can I have a child's x-ray insert? Because I can't just put a big insert.
Right, exactly. So my question is, since we were from apes and we evolved so quickly, maybe this is the evidence that it could have been tweaked. Because I can't recall any animal that has teeth problems like we have, with crowded teeth.
A shark?
they're constantly, you know.
All right.
Yeah. But anyway, that's my little theory.
But biology of that is interesting. Basically, we have two origins, and the things just don't make tons of sense. It's right. Either one or another. But I say things are just not as real as they seem.
Well, I do believe we do live in a hologram.
Yeah.
I've been studying a lot with Nassim Haramein. I've been to his opening ceremony. I know him and went to his movie premiere. And I know Mark Sims. Mark Sims is a big factor in this thing, too. Mark Sims and I trained with Dr. Greer. Mark Sims had a visitation in his hotel room with Dajbar. You can pull him out in YouTube and you'll see who Mark Sims is.
I know Mark Sims through Brian Sims.
Oh, you know Brian.
I know Brian.
This is a small world. I know their family very well. We've been camping together and we hang out. And
Brian is one of us. We have a human colony community.
Yes, he gave me we did a Skype. Yeah, he's part of the.
And Brian is one of us. He just recently did a wonderful channeling presentation.
Right.
Show, and we want more of him. He kind of, until now, he was mostly spoke for himself, and last time he spoke as a channeler, and it was just next level. Most channelers, when they speak, you kind of say, yes, yes, and when he speaks, every time he speaks, and he speaks slowly, I go, wow, it's different. It's, I don't know what it is, but, like, there is a question. And your thinking is standard, kind of standardized. You know how that question can be answered. And then he comes up with the answer is completely perpendicular to everything you would have in your mind. So that was a very nice surprise. Because when I first met Brian, he was agreed with everything. I asked him, can you say something which is not trivial? And he couldn't. But when he channels, it's just the other way around. So human Brian is physical mind of Brian is very agreeable, and channeling Brian is very unorthodox. So I communicated with Mark Sims a little, but I want more. Yeah,
you'll probably see more of him later on, because he knows me, he knows you. I think our group inspired him to have CE5 Michigan. He's because I tend to be visionary, and I tend to work on a small budget, and I like to plant the seeds and let it happen. Mm-hmm. I could see more of these teams popping up, more videos like this popping up, more cottage industries popping up with the subject matter.
Talking about small budget, can you just buy a cheap infrared camera for infrared monocular for $100 and use it? Or do you need $3,000 monocular?
I don't know. I'm not an expert at those. Maybe eBay has them. I don't know.
On Amazon, there are cheap ones and more expensive ones and terribly expensive ones. And what's the difference? I don't know.
You know what? Just work with the budget and then have it grow on its own.
Yeah, let's get the cheap one and
get the cheap one and try it. And, you know, but I think the best instrument is yourself.
Right.
Yeah, we're the best EMF detector. But, you know,
Where do you go? Which part? Do you go to the desert?
No, we actually go an hour away. This is the story. This is the weirdest story I'm telling you. It's Sipit Flats. Uh-huh. It's an hour away.
What's that? Hour away is the name of place.
It's 1 hour from San Diego.
Okay.
It's in the mountains of San Diego.
Okay.
And when you go there, it's very magical. We have the campground, but you walk inside to the valley where we're at, and it's like, wow, you can feel it. You can really feel it. And then in our place, there's a circle of grass mm-hmm. that hasn't grown back. It's permanently there, as if something landed there.
Can you name the place, or is it a secret?
Not a secret. It's Sibbets. Sibbets Flats. It's a local place.
Sibbets Flats?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll go there when the time comes and just bring a video.
In 10 days.
In 10 days. We'll be there.
Yay!
But the story behind that was my team member Ted wanted to go there, and he always thought that would be a great idea to go there. So we went there for the first time with him, right? Mm-hmm. There's only four of us. That's when that was during the government shutdown. So we did it, and the two gigantic white orbs show up over our group. It just popped up, just went. Faded, popped up again, and went to the north against the wind. Now, before we sat down, I make people sit down wherever they want to sit. Ted was facing south, mm-hmm. and they appeared at the south. I said, Ted, they did it for you. mm-hmm. Because this is holographic universe. They know what's going on.
Right.
They did it for you, Ted. That's why, okay, we did that. That's fine. Olga, she shows up a month later with us. She says, I was here before. 10 years ago, we initiated this place with me and some other guy. What are the probabilities? This is crazy. Crazy. This is, no, there's no accidents. This is all unfolding. Mm-hmm. Now, Oga was one of my good workers. She's like 20 years younger than me. We met in Kung Fu class. I thought, I would never, like, she's a kid. I'm not hanging out with her. And now we were, like, working together on this kind of work, like, I don't know, 10 years later, this is like, wow, this is too crazy. So it's all been planned out already. Mm-hmm. So it's the matrix that we live in. And now we're talking. Amazing.
So,
And I take Russian. I will never take Russian in a million years.
I don't know why we need Russian. Maybe something is coming, but I can speak English.
Yeah, no, we can talk English. I mean, it's just that, why would I study Russian? Because the connection was Joseph Burks. Joseph uh-huh. Burks, I met him 2 years ago, and he took Russian at UCLA, and his right-hand man, Misha, which is a fictitious name, by the way, was from Russia. Mm-hmm. There's something going on. So I'm just going to run with
it. Yeah, Russia is interesting. Russia is... there is so much desire there, desire to change the world. It's kind of... You push it hard, but from that... pressure, there is a desire to change the world. So there is a lot of young people who are eager to do something. And they're very different. So the new generation comes, you know, they were born after Soviet Union fell apart. So
they don't know what that is. It's
they do know, but they
never experienced, they never lived it. Yeah,
didn't experience the restrictions. Right. So they have a fresh mind. So I'm open to work with them.
That was my dream, to... have a CE5 team in that area of the world. And there's China. I'm Chinese.
Right.
There's a lot of friggin' Chinese that can really do this probably and make some contact. That's a lot of people. So in other words, we're actually disclosing this organically on its own. We don't need the government. We don't need somebody to tell us. This is so organic. It's like one blade of grass. Mm-hmm. And more. You just can't get rid of that grass when it keeps going. So it's an organic movement. And I think we're headed that way. Fascinating. Totally fascinating. Although I may never master the Russian language, at least I could read a little bit and get uh-huh. around. Uh-huh. And I understand the culture and the history, at least. So I'm a little sensitive towards it. So, and plus I'm Chinese. I was born and raised here, but I studied Mandarin years ago to reconnect.
Can you speak Chinese?
Not anymore. I think I know more Russian than Chinese.
Can you cook Chinese?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
Qualified.
No problem. I can even cook Russian. Stuffed cabbages. Got it. But anyway, yeah, it'd be fascinating to spread to make new teams out. Yeah.
So
are they more open in Russia about this? I mean, I heard.
Yeah. Yeah. In Russia, there is a tendency to prohibit so much that the system of prohibition becomes ineffective. So it's impossible to hide things in Russia. In America, they are so efficient, they can hide things, and they can, you know, really mess up the minds of the whole country. In Russia, they overdo it, so everybody is very suspicious. And it was in Soviet Union, even in the worst times, there were people who knew everything. And now, as I read, we studied, Tolstoy. Everybody knows Tolstoy. It's one of, you know, the second name in Russian. He wrote a big book, War and Peace. And a big part of War and Peace was about Masons and satanic cult. And it was 140 years ago.
He had of his time.
Right, Blavatsky was from Russia. And 1881, she published her Secret Doctrine. And there she talks about the aliens, about creation of the new human race, the sixth race, about ascension. It's the whole book about ascension, it's theosophy, founder of theosophy, about hybridization programs. Atlantis, Lemuria, you name it. You know, it was 130 years ago, 120 years ago. So, yeah, and there are a few other Russians who were, like, writing about it, like Rerik and Andrei Bely and Gurdjieff. So, the whole country is sort of so repressive, but that culture creates stars which kind of look through and are trained to kind of look read between the lines and get the stuff out. And, my generation grew up on a book which is called Master and Margaret by Bulgakov. And surprise, it's about satanic cult, about, Luciferian cult. And it shows how the basically cabal controls the things. And it was written in 1920s, and it was written end of 20s, early 30s, finished in 36. And it surfaced in 50s, 60s, as just handwritten copies and photographed copies. And we grew up on that book. It's the main book which formed my generation. So we knew that even before, before it was popular in the West. But it was kind of fiction literature, but very profound. It kind of formed our understanding of the world.
Fascinating.
And, the author of that, he knew stuff. He was researching, and he was a son of a historian who knew stuff. They were connected to Masonic and other secret traditions.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Now we're living it.
Right, now we're living it, yes.
It's amazing. It's like, oh my God. Well, they're crumbling anyway. Because everybody's waking up. The one thing they hate is that we know. They know that we know. Anyway,
right.
They like to be in the dark and work in the back. No, we already know. It's old news. Sorry.
Old news, right.
We're all meditating. We're all going out in the field. We're all making contact.
Right. The story about human colony. I told it a million times, so my people already know it. It's a short story. But basically, first thing I said to this dude was, I'm applying for a visit, right? So it was I was into Reiki, and Jim, my friend, was into Reiki. I just met him, and he was funny. He looked like a redneck, and he still looks like a redneck. Too simple, right? But so positive, so forward-going. I was suspicious. If people are too forward-going, you become suspicious. What is his interest? Why he would be that forward?
With motivation to doing this, yeah.
But he's still wonderful and forward-going. He's just an enlightened guru. Mm. And anyway, he started channeling. He said, do you know the aliens are around? I said, sure, aliens are always around me. Because I was told many times. Not that I feel them, but
right.
I told many times. I Pleiadians, blah, blah, blah. So he said, they want to speak to you. I said, sure. And he kind of let one of them enter. It was this dude. And he said, I'm this dude. I've watched you for a while. And I said, I'm applying for a visit. For a visit. And he said, we'll consider your application.
He's applying for a visit.
Right. They have a bureaucracy.
I think that's hilarious. That's how...
They have a bureaucracy. You have to apply.
Yeah, yeah, got it. I was like, wow. Right. Need a visa.
You need a visa, right.
Extraterrestrial visa.
Right. Exactly. I mean, it's electronic, but it's still a visa, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he said, but, you know, we need to test your chemistry if you're compatible with our teleportation thing. I don't think Jim at that time knew the word... worded right, but it was understood, like teleportation. So I said, sure, I give my approval. Next morning, I wake up, I have marks on my body.
Oh, scoops or just...
Like mosquito, big fat mosquito or bee bites.
Right.
They were 7 in geometric pattern, like angle.
Oh, okay.
And they stayed there for half a year. And right here.
Yeah.
And first, again, I would photograph the UFO. I would photograph myself because it is a private matter. They, you know,
I totally believe you. I was like...
But later, yeah. Later when it started fading and my belief started fading, I photographed just for myself to remind myself it was real.
Right.
So that was my first experience. It's very tiny, right? You know, it's like, it's called stigmata. Like if you really believe... You get it, right? You know, mm-hmm, the stigmata, right?
Right, yeah, no.
Uh-huh.
Right.
So...
I did the Bach B minor, I understand.
You did what?
Christ stigmata. It's a fugue, the B minor fugue.
B minor?
Yeah, the B minor fugue, book 2.
What is that?
Johann Sebastian Bach's Prelude and Fugues. There are 24 sets, 2 sets. They had stigmata, and the fugue was based on 5 notes, and it made the melody. Stigmata.
It is a musical?
Yeah. Yeah, it's you know, he based it on the Christ crucifixion points.
Oh.
Stigmata.
And you play it?
Yes, it's the B minor. If you analyze the fugue, it's a stigmata in there.
A fugue. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, rough topic, but yeah, now
I don't know that language, right? Fugue. Now I'm going to translate it.
Fuga, yeah, fuga.
Fuga. Yeah.
Shostakovich, he did fugue also. Dmitri Shostakovich, he did the Preludes and Fugues.
Got it.
20th century.
Got it.
Totally cool. Anyway, back up. Stigmata, you had these marks.
Right. I don't understand Shostakovich. He's too complex for me.
Yeah, it's more for the, you know.
I like simple.
People like me.
I like shamanic sound. Yeah, and yeah. African sound.
Yeah, yeah. I totally get you.
Simple. Ha, ha, ha. Yeah, ha, ma. That's simple.
I know.
All right.
Anyway, back to stigmata.
So, so they didn't take me, but it started me thinking, and I was thinking, I knew already, by that time, I researched David Wilcock was threatened by... some bad guys. And he came to the interview the same day. He came to the interview with Kerry Cassidy. And it was a radio interview. Basically, his sound, he just called. He called. And he said, I'm threatened. And something happened. So someone called to the same radio show.
Mm.
And that someone was anonymous, but he sounded as I understood, he was speaking from secret space program somewhere from outside of the Earth.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So that was my understanding.
Yeah.
So I realized, and I started researching it, I realized there are humans out there, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not that all humans are here, all aliens are there. There are humans out there that grew up here and were taken there later. So basically us,
mm-hmm.
us in the space.
Mm-hmm.
And there are different branches of that program. So I thought, I want to join them. But if I join them, I want to bring my friends and my family and make a settlement there. And there is a need for someone to explain to the aliens what is there. What we are.
Mm.
Because when I started speaking to the aliens through the channeler, they were completely misunderstanding us. There was so little understanding that it was just laughable. Mm-hmm. They look at us, they were happy thinking about global problems, but they couldn't understand individuals. They couldn't understand politicians. They couldn't understand the governments, couldn't understand the economy. Mm. So those aliens who I spoke to, like, they were completely, like, ignoring the things. And I said,
how about unimportant for them.
Yeah, you take us there, and we will make a settlement there, and we'll explain it to you, the stuff. And then we do what the West did for the Soviet Union, to help the Soviet Union to fall apart and then reform. So the main idea, I experienced that from the Soviet Union. There was, it's called Voices, radio programs from the West. There was Voice of China, Voice of America, Voice of Germany, I think. I'm not sure if it was called Voice of Germany, but it was a couple German stations. And my favorite was Radio Liberty. Radio Liberty was amazing, and it's still amazing. But at that time, it was instrumental because these were our people who emigrated. So they knew the stuff from inside. And that was the only voice who spoke with compassion. Mm. It was sad, compassion, loving voice all the time. And everything else was so lame. Like, all radio programs in Soviet Union were lame. You didn't trust anything they would say. But whatever said Radio Liberty, it was reasonably trustable. Reasonably. Because there was that feeling there, which...
Right, you see, so you just know. You just know.
You just know, right?
You know the bullshit, you know, and what's coming is real.
Yeah. So I said, how about we start Radio Liberty up there? We create a settlement there, and we start radio, whatever, alien... radio-friendly aliens, or radio-friendly Russian colony. Mm. Not Russian, human colony. So I called it human colony.
Mm-hmm. Earthlings.
Earthlings, yes. Earthlings. And I wrote a whole book about it. It was like 2 months. I was just writing the letters for them. And I said, I created a Gmail for you. I will write my messages to that Gmail, and you can upload them, you know. They should be able to access our Gmail, right?
Yeah.
Not that they did, but at least they should be able to. When I asked them in channelings, usually they didn't bother by some reason. I don't know why. But anyway, when I finished the book, they said they read it, they liked it, and it's helped them a lot. And that many, many aliens read it, which I believe, I mean, it's a nice book. It's called Welcome to Earth, A Guide for Aliens. So I read that book, and then it was, I guess, in the summer, and... in September 2013, we kept a couple times a week with Jimmy. We kept doing the channeling sessions. And I said, you know, so you basically they confirmed that they approved starting the colony. Yeah, it was end of September. Our friend Takur said it was approved. And I said, do you mind inviting people on record? And she said, I invite people. So I say, how about we just create an address and people would write there and apply. You know, that's simple, right? If you have a contact with the alien, they say, we approve, so we can create an email address and people would write. So, and that started the community online. Basically, I published it in several places, started the website, started the YouTube channel. And tons of people joined us and applied. And there was an expectation that they will start taking us, right? And some people experienced, many people experienced at least the interview. The interview, basically, you apply next night, the same night, somebody comes to you like in astral projection state and they interview you. So many, many people confirmed that. They experienced that. And some people remember it going there, but most of the people don't. Mm. And I remember things like as dreams. Mm. Like I see people, I hold a child. I remember like a moment, like flashing memory. I hold a child and it's very dear to me, right? And things of that sort. So most of that is kind of, I don't know, we still don't know why. And they say they don't know why, but they take us as some sort of holographic projections, and very little memory is kept. Mm. Elena Kapulnik visited there, and she remembers stones more, and it's already on record, we asked her. So the colonies sort of exist, but they exist in some reality which is not very easily to address, access.
Mm-hmm.
But the community there, we have a few hundred people, we channel, and now we speak galactic languages. It's another story, basically. Many people speak languages for a lifetime, and then they find us, and they discover that there are other people who speak the same language. Most popular is Arcturian. Another popular is Lyran, Pleiadian, and snake language, reptilian language, so on. So that's another... that's a great confirmation. At some point... like Jim Kama came up with Arcturian language, someone else came up with Arcturian language. We had like more than 15 people speaking Arcturian language. We have we had a webinar where, like, we do it all live. Where 9 people spoke Arcturian language, taking turns, and playing a play, some sort of a play, and then Jim translated what it was. And then he found a young lady who speaks that Arcturian language, who published that maybe 10 years before us, or maybe 7 years before us. So that was a nice confirmation. So people independently come up with the same language. Not many understand it, but some do. Some do. Now Wendy is pretty good. Brian is very good. Brian Sims is very good with galactic languages. He speaks perfect Arcturian, right?
Interesting. Has it been recorded?
Yeah, it's all
on YouTube somewhere.
We do it like live and recorded on Hangouts. Right. We have like tons of videos, hundreds of hours of videos, and it's like 3 years now. Mm. And every Saturday we have a webinar when somebody channels and there is like 10, 20 people asking questions.
Right.
It's all live and recorded all the
time. God, you're way over there. Yeah, you're way over there.
Yeah, way over there.
Yeah, we're just down home, folks, just trying to make contact.
Yeah, we have the contact, right? But it's channeled contact, right?
Yeah.
I want more tangible.
Right.
I got my confirmation, so I'm happy. Like most of my confirmations are of spirit nature. I basically there is that suspicion. Theory that, what if aliens are not real? What if spirits are real? And it's conspiracy of the spirits.
Right, now it's back. Yeah,
that
yeah,
they
yeah,
pretend to be aliens.
Right, right. You don't know!
You gotta test it, right?
You have to test it. You have to get no fear. Collect the data. Sort it out.
But
Tom Campbell mentions this also. Maybe this is just a gigantic hologram. And the guy who's running the program is inserting all the data. It's not just the right direction.
I interviewed several experiencers who visited the ships, and their stories are so real. So it's pretty real.
Yeah. Like I said, maybe they're so advanced it seems paranormal. That's all. And I think it's hard for us to distinguish ghost activity and their activity. It's so close.
Yeah, another suspicion.
I always tell during our contact work, I know you hear the spirits, but not tonight. We have a date with E.T. I always put that out there. I don't want to ruin the data tonight. Well, but we'll see you next week. Just to be polite.
No, I do it all the time, yeah. Sometimes E.T.s bother me. Like, when their stories are not coherent, I say, let's speak to angels. And angels are much more... So they're authorized. ETs are not authorized to release a lot of information. And angels are messengers. They are much more. They have more authority. So when ETs cannot answer a question, invite an angel, and angel will answer that. So, So when ETs disappoint you, invite angels.
Okay. Well, I'll invite angels then.
Let's take a breath.
game, we usually play the app, the meditation app. It's nice to have somebody live.
Sure.
Because I'm not a trained meditation expert, so I have to put on Dr. Greer's spiel, you know.
In the past life.
Bring it on.
No, it's natural for me. I'm surprised, but it's so easy for me to do the thing, like meditative things, right, to guide it. When I'm in the church, I associate myself with people on there, on the altar. I have been a priest in many lifetimes, so it's kind of a priest or shaman. So.
Right, right.
And genetically, I studied my genetics. You know, I have a series of Jewish rabbis in my ancestry.
Right, 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 right.
And the most famous one is Maharal of Prague. It's called Maharal of Prague and Yehuda ben Lev. And he is the one who created Golem. Have you heard about Golem?
No. Golem? Golem, not the other one. That's very close.
What?
Golem?
Golem.
No, I don't know Golem.
Yeah, it was like in Czechia in about 600 years ago. There was those Jews were persecuted.
Mm-hmm.
And Jewish settlement, they created a robot called Golem. And Golem first, he kind of threw away the offenders, mm-hmm, but then he went out of control, so my ancestor had to turn it off. So that's the story. Like I think it's a legend, but that's how he's known in modern movies, like Golem.
Right, right. Well, great. So if you can lead the meditation, that'd be great. Because we have another guy, too, just in case he doesn't show up, or just in case he just wants to relax for the evening. He's our Kundalini guy.
Kundalini. I love Kundalini. Sure.
Yeah, be good. I always wanted this team is much stronger. This part two team is much stronger than the first team. We have a lot of energy workers on board, which is nice to have. You know, yeah.
So I have a couple of friends who work with vortexes, and I don't know the technology yet. I don't know the technique or the steps, but it feels that I want to do it.
Vortex?
Yeah, natural vortexes. Basically, the idea is that the vortexes are conscious.
Mm-hmm.
And they're pretty powerful, so you don't control them, just become friends with them. And my friend went to... Her name is Lucia. She is Russian Jewish. And she went to the places of Jewish Holocaust in Northern Europe, in Baltics, and she had to do lots of healing on the energies of the area. So she does that. She comes, does meditation, basically, performs certain rituals, certain work. And recently she went to Egypt to do the same thing. So she works on big things. She just will work, you know, she's called to do that. She's kind of very powerful magician, I would say, or spirit worker. So I need to ask her what's the technique, what do you actually do? But as I understand, it's all the same stuff. You kind of come together in, as a group, make a circle, meditate, raise your vibration first to reach the vibration of the vortex. And then, as I usually do, we sing the songs and chant for the vortex to give it our love. What else can we do, right? Give our love and praise and honor. There is not much more. And send our healing. I guess everything on earth needs healing, so that's what we do. We're healers. I teach healing, I teach Reiki, and that's fun. I can feel the energy. So I recently experienced, I guess, should I tell it on camera? I will tell it.
You can always edit it out.
No, I don't like editing. Oh, editing okay. Is hard. You have to scroll and find and sophisticated. Okay. And the files are huge. It's just, you know, we upload everything on YouTube. That's it. So I just will tell in a general sense. I found a place, or created or found a place. It's really hard to tell what was first. But I was kayaking on the ocean. It's, you know, very lazy kayaking. There was no waves. You saw my kayak, right? So I go on the ocean and I chant all the time. I know the ocean is conscious and it's big and it is it's part of the matrix and it's like God. It's
right.
It's manifestation, one of the manifestations of God. Or feminine part of God, fluid part of God. So you kind of become friends with it. And last time when I enter, there are waves coming, and this time it was completely flat, like no waves. So all the surfers, they were very unhappy. But, you know, for me, it's just, you know, go chant there. So I enter that, and out of nowhere, like no waves around, one big wave comes to me, like from nowhere, like, and flashes at me, so I'm all wet, in wetsuit. I say, okay, I laugh. How probable it is that, you know, out of nowhere. And I say, stop it, stop it. And in response, the second wave, even bigger, like, flashes on me. I say, okay, I got your humor. You just have to be careful when you go to the ocean, even though there is no waves. Anyway, I go out, and I chant there. And recently, I was attracted to a guru, female guru, called Ananda Mai Ma. She was around maybe 50 years ago, 50 to 100 years ago. It's like her lifespan there. And I was connected to her in my past life. So she was wonderful. She was spaced out most of the time. And her students, followers, devotees were just taking care of her. And she did miracles and just connected. Basically was meditating most of the time. And when I started chanting her name, I noticed that the water around me became very smooth. Like around it was rough, but the circle around me was smooth. And as a scientist, I needed to like experiment and control, right? What if it is just, it just seems like if you move to the other place, well, it becomes rough again. So I moved to another place, it was rough again. And I kind of was kayaking there, I was coming back, I saw dolphins. I love dolphins. It was like maybe fifth time I see dolphins. And I came closer to them, I was chanting to them, and then the birds started coming. And we have in 𝗪𝗘𝗕𝗜𝗡𝗧𝗘𝗡𝗧, there is a huge number of birds. So about 200 big birds came, and I was a little bit scared because just too many. But, you know, I thought it's maybe something spiritual is happening, so I will be happy and pretend that I know what I'm doing. But I was chanting, kind of sitting in place, looking at, for dolphins and looking at the birds. So they made a circle around me. And they span around me for about quarter turn. So I think they created a vortex or they marked the vortex. And I figured out there was a fish underneath, so they kind of was fishing. They were landing and kind of diving to catch fish. But in any way, they made a circle and they spun around me. And I kind of mapped this place. So I want to go there again and see maybe it is a constant static vortex where you kind of come there and experience something in the ocean. It's not very far. It's the area where kayakers always go, or La Jolla Shores. They can hang around there. But I think it's a special place there. So that was my first experience with the vortex. And then my friend, her name is Allison. She said she is very very psychic. She found another vortex on the beach and told me where it is. So I went and meditated there. And I thought, maybe that's Allison's. How about I find my own vortex? There should be other vortexes.
Yeah, yes.
And just kind of places of where the energy is concentrated.
Right. You mentioned I saw that in your...
Uh-huh. Yeah. And when I was kayaking, I just looked around and I was really attracted to one place. I said, oh, that would be mine. I like it. I really liked it. So I found it on the map. Then I went there. It's nice. It's not big. It's small. It's small and smooth because some of them are like really huge. It's really hard to relate to a huge vortex. It's just too much for us, for a human. And so I started that. I made an invitation on Facebook and... Denise responded.
Yeah, right? I saw that, yeah.
So that's just the beginning, but now I am sort of practicing my ritual ceremony because I have to figure out what to do, right? So the celebration ceremony. But I really like it. I really want to do
those. Yeah, a good vibe. You had a good vibe there, yeah.
I really want to do those. There is tons of vortexes, and it's a way to connect to them and to energy, and also get healing. I think we go both ways. We get healing and send healing.
Right.
So that feels really, really nice. I'm really excited. As soon as I got that idea, that was like, I'm obsessed about it, just working on vortexes. And I don't see many people around doing that. It's sort of new, I think.
Well, yeah, you have a niche now, so you have a niche in that area, and you write stories and books about it and how to do it and protocols,
yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you're way beyond us. You're way over there.
We can do the same thing on
in our little area. Yeah, there was definitely something going on there.
Outing.
You'll feel it. Oh my God, you'll feel it. It's enormous. It used to be an Indian site.
Ah.
So I think the spirits are there, and I think they made contact back in the day. The Indians, the Sendigitos, and this is what happened. Olga decided to do a medicine wheel at our site. And it's tobacco, right? So, after that, we had the same tent together. When she went to our tent, she heard footsteps. And she thought it was me. And she says, she went to me at the fireplace. I says, was that you over there, Pete? No. She heard footsteps. There were footsteps over there by the tent. And it was the classic case of the invisible footsteps.
Uh-huh.
It's very common in our CE5 work. So I think, okay, then I researched the area, why is it tobacco? So I called up my archaeologist friend. I asked him, what kind of religious things do they use in this particular Indian site, the Sendigitos? Tobacco. Interesting. So it either could have been the spirits, or it could have been ET playing with us, or...
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, Olga is very connected, yeah.
Yeah.
She did channelings for me.
Okay, so you know Jeet, right?
Jeet, yeah.
Yeah, we're part of that. She had I met Jeet through Olga, through her meditation weekly meetups.
Weekly?
About a year ago, 2 years ago. We'd meditate, and that's how I met Jeet at his apartment.
Uh-huh.
And I mentioned the UFO thing. He was a little fascinated, and I did the what do they call it? A hot house. I forget what they call that thing. A sweat lodge.
Uh-huh.
Did that for the first time with him. It's kind of a close knit community going here with the.
Right.
Yeah. So.
All right. My next story is. So we channel the aliens. And one of them was very talkative. His name was Lakesh. And he's still very talkative. And Lakesh in some of human languages means another you.
Mm.
So he is a Pleiadian, very short, and he's, as he described, very short and wide. He says, I'm looking like a cookie man. And they float in the air. The planet is different, they float in the air. And they're very different from us. They're human looking, I think even they are mammals, but the chemistry is very different. They can breathe some non-breathable air, eat something not
edible. Something else. Yeah.
Very different. Anyway, so I invited everybody to visit me, and him as well. And they say, yeah, maybe. They never promise anything, but say, maybe. So one night... And I, at that time, I was like really eager. So I moved my bed away from my wife so they can visit me, right? And not to scare my wife, right? so much suffering for
them. I know. How can she put up with this?
Right. Anyway, I'm sleeping by myself. And I experience a nightmare. It's like a really, really scary nightmare. Not specific storyline, but just a sensation of real fear.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember having many of those in my early childhood. like, it's always like the idea that I'm so small and out of control and things are huge, like planets are big, and I'm like really scared. And I'm losing myself, basically. And this time, after many years, now I'm 53, so after many years, I get the same, I think it was a couple of years ago, so 51, just the same thing. And I thought, maybe it's aliens coming. And as I realized, maybe it's aliens coming. So I woke up, oh, that's maybe aliens. And there was like a vibration, like, not outside, but inside. I have it once in a while, so it's nothing new, but kind of strong vibration. And I said, if you're aliens, come on in. I will not be afraid. It was a conscious decision. Okay, I'm not afraid. And it came in, and I felt myself being in the two bodies, in my body and in another body, which is very short and fat.
Mm.
So I think I could have moved his fingers a little bit. Mm-hmm. I didn't try to do any active things because I was afraid to spook it. Mm-hmm. And I hoped they would start speaking to me, but there was no communication. Maybe I was closed, but I was certainly awake, and certainly there was a visitation there. It was something unmistakable. Never again I experienced that. So I was awake, and then after maybe 15 minutes being there, it left, and here I am, like nothing happening.
So there's reasons why that all happened.
Yeah, and then I went to sleep, and I was, and then I, you know, talked to Jim, and we channeled Lakesh. Lakesh said it wasn't him, but it was his compatriot who would, like, from the same planet who visited me.
Right.
Because I invited. I said, can I have more?
I think our task have already been planned out already. So you're tasked for something else, probably.
Yeah, exactly.
So it can be
Because I telepathy on camera, they cannot give me more because it will be visited on camera, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, Mark had his visitation. And he merged in with Tejbar, came inside his body for 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
It was a long visit, but it rocked his world. I mean, he was very much not into this engineer left brain.
Yeah, Brian told me that, you know, he introduced him.
Totally changed everything. And,
right.
Yeah. So, yeah, you know the story. And
a little bit.
Yeah. One day you'll interview Mark, so.
What?
One day you'll interview Mark Sims.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, I like it too.
Yeah. So, yeah, we'll meet. But, yeah. Now we are.
Tell me more of your proofs. What experiences did you have?
My experiences is just actual synchronicities and orbs sewn up, being touched, forehead, a feeling of, I love going camping anyway. I love doing it outdoors. And
I like camping, yes.
Yeah. I liked that perhaps they're watching over me. At this time in my life, they follow you home. I believe I need as much protection as I can. And I don't channel. I don't sense, you know, like you do. I think my task is to organize people, to get them together, and do it. And I have the energy for it. I think what one person told me, they like the purity of my heart, because I don't want money out of this, which makes it even more legit. Our team does not charge anything. Mm-hmm. We just ask for good coffee and food. We go camping, we'll share our food, that's it. Or we can split the camping fee, that's it. We don't require, because we don't want to, you know, it just feels weird. A lot of other people charge, and we don't charge anything.
I'm thinking about charging for our service. So far, we did most of the stuff for free on our community, but...
Yeah. It's different in the Reiki community, you know? It's different not in the Reiki, Yiel and the...
Human colony.
Human colony thing.
Channeling things. I'm thinking about starting a subscription, because other channelers do subscriptions. Maybe we should do.
Right.
But that would be complementary, like two parallel lines. We do free stuff, and we'll do paid stuff, maybe.
Right.
I still need to get consensus.
Or if we do a pay thing for our group, it would pay for cameras, or it'll pay for, you know, the EMF detector, you know, tools for the trade.
I don't know. There should be a nice model. I guess first you become popular, and then you kind of control things with the money a little bit.
Mm.
But it should be accessible to people.
Yes.
The main idea is to make it accessible.
Yeah, it's we always train people for free. They actually come and then they form their own teams.
What's the process? Can you share any of the process?
We just follow the protocols in the ET app.
Ah.
ET contact tool. Just follow the instructions.
What's the name of the app?
ET contact tool.
ET
contact tool.
Tool.
It's
okay.
It's Dr. Greer's thing. It's great for the beginner, and it goes through the protocols, and voila.
So you install it, and then you come to the campsite?
Yeah, we just plug it in and play the tone. The tones are important. We like the crop circle tones.
Ah.
Those are pretty. I like that. It's very relaxed. Okay. And I have a singing bowl. I do that. It's very nice. And then, I'm not a meditation instructor, I just play Dr. Greer's meditation thing. And
uh-huh.
But I actually enjoy just a silent meditation.
Uh-huh.
Just completely quiet.
Uh-huh.
And just listen. And
so basically you meditate?
No. That's the hardest part. Staying awake and meditating and staying warm.
Ah.
That's the hardest part. Doesn't.
How long do you have to meditate?
You can last for an hour. You can last for. Well, we take breaks. You know, bathroom breaks and take.
Okay.
And sometimes it can go real quickly. Things pop up, and then you have a show. Things show up, and then it stops.
So you meditate with open eyes or closed eyes?
Doesn't matter. You can keep it open to watch the skies. I prefer closed.
Mm-hmm.
Some people. I went to the Enrico Villanueva. Enrique, he was part of the Sixopots, South America.
Okay.
He's in L.A. He's very, they were the ones that started the CE5, way before Dr. Greer.
Okay.
And I went on his training last year in Mount Shasta.
Okay.
And it's the Brahma group, and they have protocols, and they do chanting.
Okay.
Rama, many times, it's a voice.
Nice.
Rama, and they have a relationship with extraterrestrials, a certain beings that show up. It's called the Rama group. They actually did CE5 way before Dr. Greer's formation.
Okay.
Yeah. And Enrique,
so that's it. You come out. Why do you need the application?
Oh, it helps filter out people.
What do you mean, filter out?
Filters out people that either they don't meditate, or they're afraid of extraterrestrials, they're going
to
abduct them.
So you came to the camping ground, and then you get filtered out?
Well, before they could come with us,
uh-huh.
We have them fill out this questionnaire.
Okay.
And if they don't fill it out, they're not that serious.
Oh, so it's just a barrier.
Yeah, a barrier, yes. But then we have a personal interview. To see who you are, get a good feeling.
Okay.
Make sure you're not crazy.
I am crazy, for sure.
Well, but at least you're nice crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, who is not?
Yeah. because, you know, once you get, you know, we don't like, we had a group one time, and then somebody told us about us, and they showed up, and it kind of disrupted the whole chemistry.
All right.
Who's this guy coming out of nowhere?
Right. Yeah, it happens.
Yeah, it's the cohesion part, and everybody that doesn't like surprises during our group sessions. But once it's set, it's pretty much closed for that night, so we can all.
So why do you need an application there, the app? Why do you need the app on the site? You don't.
It just helps for the beginner.
Oh, the sound. It gives you a sound.
The sound. I like the sound.
Okay.
Everybody has the app, so you don't have to worry about it. So we have the app.
No, I'm trying to figure out the technology. So there is no technology, basically. Yeah, you just meditate, and that's it.
Right, because Rama doesn't have an app. They chant. And they have writers. They call it.
To do what? Automatic writing?
Chant, yes. They emphasize automatic writing. And he said you're either an antenna or not an antenna.
Okay.
You're probably an antenna. You can sense some.
Maybe.
But, yeah.
Okay.
The last person I haven't seen is James Gilliard.
I don't know. Who is that?
He's another contactee. He's in Washington.
Okay.
He had profound experiences. He has a ranch.
Okay.
And he trains people up there. It's very cheap, and things show up at his ranch.
Uh-huh.
It's a big vortex there. Look him up, James Gilliard.
Okay.
He's really way out there.
Okay.
James Gilliard.
Oh.
Yeah, G-I-L-L-I, yeah. Something. East City Ranch, East...
I know that it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All
right. Besides how to describe this guy, value-wise, low cost, high value.
Okay.
For the amount you spend there, it's like $25 a night, and then to see him is like $125.
Okay.
Now, that the guru is different. He's the wine and cheese crowd, I call. He's $3,600 just for a week with the guy.
Okay.
Excluding the hotel and food. So you're going to spend some money when you see this guy. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's a different crowd, different set. But
I understand.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was blessed by my channeled beings to go into that path, basically, to start show up in the in those communities.
Mm.
I don't know how to do that. But and I don't know even what's the specifics of my message yet. But sort of, I was always attracted to public speaking. Maybe I can do some.
Yes, something. I could see that. I could see you doing the slideshow.
Yeah, maybe a slideshow. Maybe dance or something.
Dance, whatever. Because there's MUFON in San Diego. They always want speakers to speak.
Really?
That's a different crowd. It's a different crowd.
I tried. They didn't accept me.
They're kind of very 50s and very Cold War.
If you mention channeling, they
get scared. They don't allow that. Yeah.
They don't like channeling.
Yeah.
But so,
they know who we are. I mean, I said, dude, things show up. I don't care what you say. It's through meditation. And you know what I say? If you don't believe in it, that's okay. We just leave you behind. We're moving forward. Uh-huh. That's why people like you're getting older, you die off. We have a new generation coming.
Right. Uh-huh. Yeah, we will die off too.
Right. But at least we're planting the new seeds for the new generation that is coming on board. Because I see a lot of these kids are very accepting of this and quite curious about contact.
Uh-huh. Yeah, technology-wise, I'm into technologies. I'm researching stuff, but again, it's kind of I'm getting stuck there. It's like I'm into light therapy, you know, red light, infrared light, all fancy electromagnetic things.
Mm.
I have lots of toys.
Mm-hmm.
Toys for meditation, for healing, stuff like that. But some of them are efficient, but there is no...
Oh. In the field, we get flashes of light on us.
Ah.
They come down and they... I think it's an upgrade. Because I notice my ESP gets a little better every time I go out in the field and I come home. Oh, yeah. The bus shows up in 3 minutes all the time for me now. Because I just know. Weird. But yeah, me and Cameron experienced it. Flashes of light.
Nice.
And they say it's an improvement to your DNA or an upgrade.
Right. I have a DNA background, so I guess my main contribution could be someday, the code for DNA, because the code is not yet discovered yet. The code...
Morphogenic field, that's right.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So the code for the morphogenic field. The codes which have been discovered so far are simplistic, basically how the DNA encodes the proteins. That is discovered like 50 years ago. But that covers only about 2-3% of the sequence. And the rest of the 97% of the sequence still is not deciphered. And we understand that morphogenetic code, the wave code, how it resonates, it's up to deciphering. So we are looking for the patterns, how the DNA resonates. And somehow our channeled friends, they don't tell us by some reason. They give us a little bit of help, but I guess it's up to us to discover that. Because the sequence is there, we know our sequence and all. But basically, if you give to a scientist, the modern geneticist, a sequence of a human and of a mouse. And if they don't have a reference database, they cannot build a mouse from the sequence. The nature can, but the science doesn't understand where is the shape of the mouse written in the sequence.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, how the does the DNA generate that field? How do you generate the body, the etheric body?
Right.
It should be written there, and it should be decipherable. There is some language, some patterns, and I have some ideas how it is written there, but... You know, one person doing it part-time is not sufficient. You, like, really need more people, more funding, and more focus on that. But we kind of try, and there are other people who are looking in generally in that direction. But I guess it takes a combination of knowledge in physics, in water structure. Somehow it's all related to water structure, basically. The DNA shapes the water, and water shapes the DNA, something about that.
And the memory of the water, maybe, there. Yeah. Is memory going on and senses? And there's and we're actually light beings. There's a little bit of light that comes out of the cells that we can't see. Yeah.
Yep. Via photonics. Yeah.
Yeah. I remember reading that somewhere. Yeah.
Yep. So the best scientist in that direction, strangely, but it's David 𝗪𝗘𝗕𝗜𝗡𝗧.
Really?
Yeah.
He always has an entourage of beautiful women with him.
David 𝗪𝗘𝗕𝗜𝗡𝗧. Sounds non-serious, but in what he wrote, he did most serious research in that direction. He's more like an encyclopedia type of mind. He would collect everything and rewrite in the book, but he pronounced it like really strongly in several of his books how it should be. He didn't discover it, but he is good. His science is pretty good. He's always overstating. So if he says something is proven, it means that somebody mentioned it.
Right.
It doesn't mean that it's proven, but... But the idea is he is intuitive, so intuitively he gets the ideas really
right,
well.
Right.
So his book, Source Field Investigation, is right to the point. He's really good. Second crazy person is Dan Winter.
I know Dan Winters.
You do?
He's my friend. I mean, I'm on Facebook.
Wow.
I don't understand some of his stuff, but he's way out there, I swear.
He's way out there.
He's a fucking way out there. I got his papers, I'm reading. I don't know how to do this. I feel so stupid.
Yeah, I'm looking at him since, I guess, 2001. It's like now 15 years. And at that time, I was very suspicious. He like was like too much out there.
Oh, God. Tell me
and
about
now,
it.
And now...
Makes a lot of sense.
It makes a lot of sense, yeah.
Yes.
His main video was done maybe 10 years ago, and it's still so beautiful. It's all kind of channeled by him. It's just amazing.
Right.
I spoke to him once on the phone, and he was not easy to communicate with. He was not answering the questions. Right. He was pushing his agenda so much, there was no conversation.
Well, he's an engineer, for God's sakes. You know how they are.
Right. I'm an engineer, too. But
they can't be focused just for that.
Yeah, but he is great. So
yeah,
Dan Winter, 𝗪𝗘𝗕𝗜𝗡𝗧, and Richard Allen Miller. Richard Allen Miller is an older guy with long hair and laughing loudly. And Kerry Cassidy interviewed him. Now he's all over the place on YouTube.
Right.
So Richard Allen Miller also knows stuff. And I emailed with him a few times, and he gave me excellent advice. So he was right to the point. He said, look at... how do you call it? Microtubules.
Yes. I read about microtubules. It's for the consciousness connection.
Really?
Yes, the microtubules in your brain. There's a doctor called Dr. Long, I think. You got it. Dr. Long?
I don't know.
I'm not sure. I'm bad with names, but he is either a surgeon or something in the medical field who discovered these microtubules.
Uh-huh.
In your brain, which is it's a possibility that's how consciousness is received as receivers.
Receivers, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, the consciousness is the brain is an antenna, right?
Right, it's an antenna. Exactly.
Right. So I looked at it, it looks reasonable. So I just need to do more work. But it's really hard to do it by yourself. Mm-hmm. I need a community of people who think about it. It has to be like Jim Watson and Francis Crick, there was at least two of them who were speaking all the time about that stuff.
Right.
So I need people who can speak and think about it.
Well, we'll put it out there on the internet and say, hey, this is what's going on. I mean, I'm sure there's another...
I'm doing it right now.
Yeah, there's another biophysicist out there with the same on board forward thinking.
Let's talk about... I have some ideas and some original ideas how to decipher that stuff. But I need more help. My brain is not big enough. I need more brain power.
Right, right.
I kind of can intuit it, but then to combine the parts, somebody needs to like really dig deeper. Like Francis Crick and Jim Watson, that's my model pair. They discovered the double helix way before others. So Jim Watson, I think he had intuitive guesses, but and he was driving force. But Francis Crick knew stuff. Francis Crick knew all the detail, all the parts. But the main step was done by Watson. The main breakthrough. He just pushed and pushed and pushed, and finally it clicked, and that was the answer. So it takes at least two people, the more the better, to think about it, to create the reality where it is manifested. So, and in terms of my...
Is this still kind of taboo-ish out there in the biology, physics world? If you start doing, I call it the woo-woo, does it hit a third rail?
People, it's not only the taboo, people just don't get it. It's like, for them, if you start speaking waves, they just, you lose them right away.
Right.
The ones who speak waves, they don't understand the importance of that. They can speak about physics of it, get excited about nanometers, and that's about it. To combine the biology, the DNA, and waves, it's alternative science. There are several more names around, like Garayev, and Fritz Albert Pope and several others. There is a community who speaks, but there are different angles at which you can approach that. So Garev gave me a blessing. I spoke to him. He said, yeah, I believe it's right. But again, he was pushing his agenda at the same time.
Right.
He wanted to sell his stuff.
Yeah. Well, can you blame him? It's his life work, yeah.
Right, so I don't know. The story about origin of humanity, origin of man is interesting, but I'm still confused about it. That's another story very interesting, which I kind of dig through, and I'm finishing the book now. Yeah, it would be like my sixth book. That would be the update on the things, and kind of the story goes that my friend's daughter, she's only 15 years old, and she's kind of a starseed child, which is very advanced.
There's a generation, I think, that's been changing, like Cameron's kids.
Yeah.
That one child can see things.
So she says, what can I read about aliens? And I look at my, all the books I know. There is nothing for teenagers who...
Oh! Ray Dove.
She What's has it?
Ray Dove, the person that you want a friend on Facebook. Okay. She has a coloring book in Amazon.
Uh-huh.
For CE5 for children.
Uh-huh.
It's really cute. I mean, it's starting. It's out there.
Okay. So, yes. So, we need more books for people who are not clouded, who don't need proving. They just want information. So, I'm writing a book where I just give it as I understand it, without proving anything. Just, Pleiadians are from Pleiades. Yahyel are from Pleiades. And so on.
Just put it out there.
Just
no sugar coated.
Yeah, exactly. Put it out there.
Yeah.
So I'm finishing that. So I guess based on that book, I will create my talk and then start speaking. First on YouTube, and then we'll see who wants me to listen. Exactly.
Yeah. Why not?
Yeah.
You gotta start somewhere. It's lonely when you first start out. You get like one view.
We have reasonable number of views. Like our usual Jim's channels are about 1,000 views.
Wow, that's
Kapulnik
a lot.
About 10,000 views.
That's a lot. It's huge.
And me is about 100 views, but no, actually 300 views. But some of my videos where I kind of get onto the right topic. You know Bashar, right? Bashar.
Yeah, I heard Bashar, yeah.
So at some point Bashar said something which was on YouTube, and then he came through Jim. Bashar says something through Daryl Anka, who is his channeler, And then Bashar is came through Jim on our webinar and also said the same thing. So I combined these two videos together and published that. It's nice, it's a nice proof when the same extraterrestrial speaks the same thing through two independent channelers. And I'm sure Jim is not watching YouTube. It's not...
Right. Oh, that's good. It's good to have confirmation through two different channelers. That's when I say, okay, there's something going on.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, we had that situation in one of our field work when one channeler sensed it and then the other guy confirmed it. Independently. It was Dr. Gray at the time. But yeah, it was fascinating. I said, wow, there's something going on. I love it.
Yeah. That's how the spirits introduced to me one of my incarnations. On the same day, I had two different channelers channeling to me. And I asked, what should I read to both of them? And they gave me the same book.
Yeah, it's confirmation right there.
That was nice.
Yeah.
They do like pretty things like that.
Right.
Nowadays.
Right. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
We can wrap it up. Is it a wrap?
Say yeah, it's bye. Goodbye, everybody. Thank you for watching. Do you have any advertisements?
No advertisements. We're just a bunch of people that go out in the field and make contact.
You don't invite any people?
We have to go through the process. So the interview, fill out the forms.
Yeah. How do they find you?
They find us through Facebook. CE5 San Diego. It'll pop right up.
Yeah, one word. CE5, Close Encounters 5, San Diego. CE5 San Diego. One word. CE5 San Diego. Search on Facebook and then you find Peter Chan.
Or one of our members. We're all on there doing our thing.
Yeah. Do you have any advertisements? Tomorrow we do Sean Swanson. Yay! Actually, I know that will be published after that. But anyway, Sean Swanson is the... Yeshua channel Yeshua from Yahyel for many years now, so it's nice to have him. And on Sunday we do Kapulnik. And I'm considering to start a subscription service on our YouTube channel. So you can find us on Human Colony on Facebook, Human Colony Group, private group. And join us on Facebook and join our discussions. And I invite, as usual, help with transcriptions of our channelings. And I invite help with hosting our webinars. Right now, Bree is doing all the hosting. And we need more work power. So if you are good with timing and technology, we can teach you, Bree can teach you, or I can teach you what buttons to press. And then we need hosts to host our Hangouts. Thank you very much, and thank you for your attention. Thank you for being with us. Have a good day.